Well, over the weekend, an in-depth look into the Obama administration's drone policy was revealed in an article in the New York Times. Now, we learned several months ago about Obama's so-called kill lists, those secret terrorist lists that the president decided he must personally give the green light for each of their targeted deaths. Well, it turns out it's not just a series of individual missions, but a permanent policy, one that we now know was sketched out in specific terms before Election Day, just in case Mitt Romney would have won. Administration officials were concerned that if clear standards and procedures were not in place, that targeted killings would simply be dictated by who's ever in office, as opposed to having a clear set of rules and guidelines to stick to. Well, Colonel Morris Davis is a professor at the Howard University School of Law, as well as a former prosecutor at Guantanamo Bay, and joins me now to talk more about this. And Colonel Davis, let's just start with this targeted killing. This is described as a whole lot of people as sort of war whack-a-mole. Once you get one, there's going to be many more to get until the game is over. Well, it turns out, in this new article especially, that this game has no end in sight.
Right. Yeah, a war on terror is a war without end, because it's really a war on a tactic, not on a group of people. So, terror can't surrender, so we'll be fighting this war for, as long as we live.
Yeah, and we should mention, even though President Obama did win a second term, this sort of, drone strike architecture mm-hmm. is still being drawn up for future leaders, for the 2016 president, whoever right. that might be. What do you think that says, that there is now an architecture in place?
Well, I find it interesting, particularly with Egyptian President Mohamed Morsi, where we've got John McCain and others here saying that the administration needs to stand up to Morsi because he can't put himself above the rule of law. But if you compare his powers to the powers that our president has taken over the past decade since 9/11, where now we can listen in on your phone calls and your emails. If we consider you a threat, the president can order you assassinated. So, compared to the powers that Morsi's taken, our president has done a lot more. So I don't know that we need a rule book. We've got the rules that we need. We have the Constitution, we have international law, the Geneva Conventions. It's complying with those rather than trying to give a president the power to put himself above those rules. And I think that was the concern here. You kind of trust Obama. But what if it had been Mitt Romney or someone else in office?
Yeah, do you think that there was a particular fear about Mitt Romney? Why do you think the president and his advisors, decided that they needed this or were most concerned about?
Yeah, I don't know if the fear was necessarily Mitt Romney, but I think they're much more comfortable, as anyone would be, when they're in charge and they hold the power, then therefore unlimited executive authority. But the prospect of leaving office and handing that over to a Mitt Romney, or if you go back to the Republican primaries where you had like a Michelle Bachmann or a Rick Perry, the thought of them at the controls of the drone program and deciding who lives and dies is a pretty scary prospect.
Well, the other thing too, even if there is sort of a rule book, as you call it, who's to say that the next person in charge can't, throw that out?
Well, that has been the argument, since 9/11, that the president, as the commander-in-chief, has unilateral authority to do anything necessary to keep the country safe. And so we've really, it's called, if you put a label on it, call it patriotic, like the USA Patriot Act.
Right.
Which is really the We're Scared to Death Act. So we give up our...
Scared to death and going to take away the principles on which this country is founded Act.
Yeah, we'll give up our liberties if you'll keep us safe. So if you put a nice label on it and call it the Patriot Act, then we're willing to give up the liberties that we claim that we're the champion of.
Something I found interesting from this New York Times article from over the weekend, it was revealed that there's not necessarily agreement behind closed doors. They may present a united front, but within the walls of the White House and Capitol Hill, the Defense Department, the CIA, they seem to want more freedom in terms of carrying out the strikes, while you have the Justice Department and the State Department and even the counterterrorism advisor John Brennan arguing for more restraint. I guess, Colonel Davis, to what extent do you think drone strikes, the impact of drone strikes is discussed? And that impact is that it has replaced Guantanamo Bay and torture at Guantanamo Bay as being the number one recruitment tool for militants, for terrorists.
Well, I guess the one good thing I took away from the article is that there is that internal debate. Because I think a lot of folks, including myself, are of the impression that the administration had kind of solve this issue, and they were all on one page in support of the program. So I guess there is a little comfort in knowing that there is still some dissent and some debate. It's also scary as well that, you know, we don't have just a drone program. We have drone programs. We have a military program that's governed by the law of war and international law, and then we have this other program governed that run by the CIA, which is a civilian agency that I'm not aware of what any internationally recognized legal authority for a civilian agency to go overseas and kill. So it is a, you know, there's still some questions that I think pose some real serious problems.
It's hard to remember, but 4 years ago, President Obama, you know, who has, you know, made himself the sole authority to give the green light to these drone strikes. It's hard to remember, but 4 years ago, this is a president who campaigned and beat his primary challenger, Hillary Clinton, because of his very strong language being against the Iraq war. This is a president who, during that campaign 4 years ago, said more times than I can even count that his intention and his promise was to shut down Guantanamo Bay ASAP. Not only is Guantanamo Bay not shut down, but most of these policies that we're seeing, that we're learning about, run so counter to that, you know, those campaign messages. I guess I want to ask you what you think happened. And of course, there's a lot of things that the general public will never know. Right. And B, why do you think the public hasn't sort of held the president accountable for these promises?
What I think happened was, I think President Obama believed what he said back in 2008 and early 2009 when he said all the right things about returning to our principles and our values and restoring America's reputation as being the champion of the rule of law. I think he meant what he said. I think he took office, you know, the economy falling off a cliff. He had health care reform was his number one priority. And then you had the Dick Cheneys and the Liz Cheneys going on and saying, you know, you're with us or you're with the terrorists. And I think in the political calculus, standing up for the rights of detainees wasn't cracking the top 10 list. So I hope, and there's some talk that, you know, in a second term, you know, when he took office the first time, he talked about a reset on relations with other countries.
Right.
In a second term, perhaps there ought to be a reset on our national security policy so that we have policies that we can live with, whether it's Barack Obama sitting behind the chair or Mitt Romney.
Yeah, and certainly some of those, you know, when first coming into office, there was sort of things written, set in stone about torture of prisoners. But what I found interesting too was there are always loopholes, and that's what makes it tough. Is you just can't do, you can't make a sweeping law, you know, at least under this administration, because you know, between the CIA and the Defense Department and the Justice Department, everybody wants to have out clauses, I guess you right. could say, in order to do that. I guess just the last thing I want to ask you is kind of what surprised you most about, you know, what came out in this article, what came out earlier this year in that article about mm-hmm. the kill list, and which direction this country's going in?
I guess what most surprised me is the access that Scott Shane has. Because we keep hearing, you know, all these indictments for people leaking classified information, but it seems like the administration, when it's convenient, particularly with, you know, some favored journalists, that leaking a little classified is not a bad thing. And it's unfortunate that we have to depend on people leaking information to keep the public informed, because our democracy is supposed to be based on an informed public that we can vote up or down, whether we want these policies or not. But if you're kept ignorant and afraid, then you trade your liberties for your security.
Yeah, when what we learn is dependent on some of these leaks, it makes you wonder just how much more we don't know, how much more isn't being leaked by these unnamed sources sometimes. Colonel Morris Davis, as always, thanks so much.
Sure.